Begin service tonight. Would there be any prayer requests to take first? All right, we can go ahead and stand then. Brother Jason, could I have you lead us in prayer tonight?
Good to be back again. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, tonight, Lord, thanking you, God, for all your blessings and all that you're doing for us, Lord. Now, Lord, there was no needs mentioned here tonight, Lord, but there is needs among your people, God. We ask, God, that you be with your children, God, that you would help them, Lord, and heal them, Lord, and set them free from their conditions, Lord, as you should see fit, Lord, for your glory and honor. Now, Lord, for this service, God, we ask, God, that you accept our praises, Lord, that just like every other time that you come here, Lord, and you be with us, Lord. And, Lord, for your servant tonight, I ask, oh, God, that you would anoint him, Lord. Give him the words that he should say, Lord. Inspire him, Lord, that we should hear, Lord, what you should have straight from you. We love you, God, and we thank you, God, for all things now. For it's in the name of the Lord, Jesus Christ, we humbly ask these things. Amen.
Well, Enoch took a stroll one day with the master, just him and the Lord alone. He got so close to the portals of heaven that God just led him on home. Oh, he keeps leading me on, destined for the throne. No time to slow down, soon we'll be home. He keeps leading me on. Oh, he keeps leading me on, destined for the throne. No time to slow down, soon we'll be home. He keeps leading me on. Well, I've struggled over mountains, walked through some valleys and thought I'd never see dawn. But the one who said, I'll never leave nor forsake you, is the one that's leading me on. Oh, he keeps leading me on, destined for the throne. No time to slow down, soon we'll be home. He keeps leading me on. Oh, he keeps leading me on. Destined for the throne. No time to slow down, soon we'll be home. He keeps leading me on. Well, I've struggled over mountains, walked through some valleys and thought I'd never see dawn. But the one who said, I'll never leave nor forsake you, is the one that's leading me on. Oh, he keeps leading me on, destined for the throne. No time to slow down, soon we'll be home. He keeps leading me on. Oh, he keeps leading me on. Destined for the throne. No time to slow down, soon we'll be home. He keeps leading me on. Well, I've been to the water and I've been baptized. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. I've been changed from this creature that once I was and redeemed is now my name. Well, I've been changed. I'm a newborn now. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. Though my sins were scarlet, they're white as snow. I was bound, but today I am free. I was lost in the darkness, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Well, I've been changed. I'm a newborn now. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. When at last in His presence I stand above, He will wipe every tear from our eyes. And I'll thank Him for giving a wretch like me a new home beyond the skies. Well, I've been changed. I'm a newborn now. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. Though my sins were scarlet, they're white as snow. I was bound, but today I am free. I was lost in the darkness, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Oh, I've been changed. I'm a newborn now. All my life has been rearranged. Oh, what a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. Well, I've been changed. I'm a newborn now. All my life has been rearranged. Oh, what a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. Oh, what a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed.
Y'all can be seated. Could I have the young sisters? Would you all have one first? And then Sister Glenda, Sister Lori, would you all have one after that?
Could we have the rest of the young people help us with this one, please?
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know.
You win. say of me, I
believe. Amen. Thank you all. All right, y'all come be seated. Sister Glenda, Sister Lori, I'll have y'all come on. Brother David, would you have a song tonight then?
You holding stand because I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
I want to thank the Lord and give him praise for something. You know, sometimes we do some stupid things. And my old truck, you know, I have trouble with it sometimes, and I had to jump it. So I pulled my car up, and I started the car, hooked up the cables. Then I'm kind of paying attention to somebody else, and I put the other ones on the truck wrong. Yeah. And all at once I got in the car, and it was like, in the truck, it was like a little puff of smoke, and I thought, oh, something's wrong. And I jumped out and disconnected, but they were sparking. And my brother told me, said, you know, it's a wonder that battery never blew up. And you know, I went to bed thinking the Lord did it didn't. You know, I thought even in her absent-minded ignorance sometimes, and I know how to do that, you know, but just not paying attention, I did it wrong. And I want to thank and praise the Lord, you know, that thing didn't blow up.
Amen. Thank you, sisters. All right. Brother David, I'll have you come on. Sister Alice, would you have a song tonight?
Here,
and I'm so thankful today that I can come in here and feel
love,
knowing
that I'm going, and I will be there soon. I love y'all.
Okay, all right. Brother David, I'll have you come on.
God's always good to give us peace in our time of need. I'm so thankful for that. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna let the hallelujahs ring. I'm gonna praise my blessed Savior's name. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. In this world of sorrow, I've seen trouble and woe. When I get to glory, I'll see no more. For I know my prayers have not been in vain. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. Sometimes I get so weary inside. Then I recall how my Jesus died. Up there I know there'll be no pain. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna let the hallelujahs ring. I'm gonna praise my blessed Savior's name. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. Up there no tears will blind my eyes, and I will walk along by my Jesus' side. I'll meet my loved ones all once again. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna let the hallelujahs ring. I'm gonna praise my blessed Savior's name. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna let the hallelujahs ring. I'm gonna praise my blessed Savior's name. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna let the hallelujahs ring. I'm gonna praise my blessed Savior's name. When I get to glory, I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. Amen.
Thank you, God. Amen. Thank you, brother. All right, y'all can be seated. Sister Alice, would you come on? And Sister Diane, would you have one after that, then?
My prayer. It's called Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I will, Lord, say when, Lord. Tell me, will, Lord, what you'd have me do. Last night, as I laid in bed, I asked him to take me by the hand, just lead me and guide me in this. Tell me, what is your will, Lord?
Sister Diane, I'll have you come on.
Can the sisters please join me?
Of the goodness.
Well, praise the Lord tonight, everybody. Good to see you here. Good to be here with you. I thought Mark was going to pick me up, but I tried to get a hold of him. I couldn't, so I hope that everything is all right with him. And just good to see each one of you and be able to meet together with you. I know that Brother Jerry Maddox is not well, so remember him in prayer. Remember Brother Steve, Sister Elsie, as they travel back this way. So may the Lord bless them as they do. And just pray for them, pray for our sister up East Chicago. Pray that Sister Zarkovich would be blessed and helped in this time of need. So, Sister Alice, you were talking about the song that she wrote and everything. I remember the phone calls I got from Brother Jack, how blessed it was to be able to hear from our brother. A lot of times he didn't have much breath, but he would talk to me, and it's just a pleasure to hear from God's children that love him. So may the Lord bless you. Come on, Brother Kevin.
Thank you, Brother Allen. We greet each one of you tonight in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we can say it's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. It's good to see those that have come in here. It's been traveling today. And thank the Lord for giving them a safe journey back. And we just look forward to what the Lord has for us. Let us look to Him tonight. And Heavenly Father, Almighty God, as we look to you tonight, Lord, we're thankful in our hearts, knowing, Lord, that you have delivered unto us thy word of truth, Lord. We know, Lord, that you are preparing, Lord, and perfecting a people in this hour, just as the scripture declares it to be, Lord. And your word will not fail, but it is yea and it is amen. And Father, as we look into it tonight, I pray, Lord, that you would anoint me as your servant, Lord, as I would stand here. That I would be able to be obedient, Lord, and speak that which you would have me to speak. And Father, that you would be glorified and honored in it all. And that it would be an encouragement and an uplift to your people. Lord, as we continue to make those strides and those steps toward the perfecting of the church. Help us, Lord, I pray. I commit this to you now, and I ask it in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. As many of you probably also deal with and suffer with the allergies this time of year. Many of us do, and I've had my bouts with it so far, but you know the Lord's, His grace is sufficient through every situation. And there we make our journey, you know, to Georgia, and the further you go south, the more blooms there are. Things are blooming out in some places down there. They had few leaves on the trees a little bit, you know, and all of that means there's a lot of pollen in the air. So we got to the funeral home and the faucet started. And so I thought, oh no. And the funeral director came up to me and he said, do you have a handkerchief? And I didn't. And he was so kind. That funeral home, I'll tell you, done such a nice job. And so they're just so kind. And As Brother Allen had already mentioned this morning, you know, when we arrived down there and we pulled into that hotel there where we stayed tonight, and there was that big billboard. It just done something to me on the inside. There was the two big Star of Davids on both sides, and it said, "Stand with Israel." Just as big as these billboards out here along I-65. And it just thrilled my heart to see that. And I did bring that out in the message, you know, and I went to Zechariah, the 12th chapter. Some may have thought, well, that's a strange message for a funeral. Which it wasn't all I spoke on. If you know me very much, I cover a lot in one message. If I really put a title to everything I touched, it would take more space on the website to list the title than it would the message. But I touched on that, and we were coming home, and Brother Allen made a statement, and he said, if they didn't hear it there, where would they hear it? And I thought, that's right. That is right, because today there is a famine for the Word of God. And we who do see and understand and have a revelation of it, when given that opportunity, we, not casting our pearls before the swine, but there was an opportunity to put something out there that if there is someone looking and seeking after truth, they're going to hear something. It's going to spark their interest, maybe, for a lack of a better way to say it. But if they're looking for something, and I believe that already, you know, a report came to me, Brother Allen, that after the services was over, there were some people there that were moved by the Spirit of God. They were touched, and just maybe, it's in God's hands, see. And there as the service was happening, I'm kind of a strange character. Probably some might think, that's all right. but I said, you may think this is strange in a funeral, but that's all right. You know, His ways, they're much higher than ours. And I said, if you're looking for the Lord, He's able to save your soul right here in this funeral home. There's no specifics. There's no kind of an outline that you have to be in a certain locality or building. No, it's just when you come and you meet Him face to face and you give it all to Him. I've heard of many a testimony of where different ones have given their life to the Lord in different various places. But I let them know, and I said, you know, a funeral, it's not for the living, or it's not for the dead, but it's for the living. Amen. And if I can help someone, that's what I want to do. So we thank the Lord for giving us a good journey, safe trip, and everything went very well, and I know the family was very well pleased. And all I can say is, may the Lord have His way in all that was said and done. There, as we made our way toward the I had planned maybe to put some pictures up tonight, but I didn't get it all quite in time, and that's no one's fault. I'm just saying I waited too long. And I thought, well, I will just let you see a visual. Because, brother, sister, as Brother Allen has already said, I'm reiterating. And I told the funeral directors and some there, I said, you know, this country could take a great lesson in respect from the state of Georgia for what we saw displayed there. As we drove down that four-lane highway, and brother, sister, on the other side, headed in the opposite direction, they pulled off the road. Come to an intersection, and it was very large, and they all stopped. For 11 miles, we traveled across this road, and they would pull off. Then we get to the little town there where the cemetery was, and there was a ball game going on. And those little fellas and the coaches there, they took off their hat, and they put it over their heart. And there those coaches were. I've got that picture. There those coaches were, and they got down on one knee just like this. You know what they were doing? They were teaching those young boys something. That you respect God and the giver of life is what they were doing. That's right. Hallelujah. It touched my heart. How many loves the Lord? You know, I want to say we're a blessed people, blessed beyond measure. There, before I just come up to the front, I was listening to the songs, and oh my, what an anointing is on this place. What an anointing is here. The presence of God is overshadowing us. Hallelujah. I believe He is very well pleased. Amen. I believe that we are assembled together as believers. Amen. All with the same desire in our hearts, allowing God to work in and through us to bring about that of His will and purpose in each and every one of us. And as the scripture says about edifying itself in love, I see that, brother, sister. I see it. I want to go to the book of Ephesians. I want to read something there out of the fifth chapter. What a great act of love. It's, maybe I shouldn't use the word act. I should retract that word, but what a great outpouring and show of love, demonstration of love that was shown at Calvary, where Jesus Christ gave His life for you and I. Amen. That we would have access, amen, to the throne of God for forgiveness of sin. That we could be reconciled back to God. For without that, brother, sister, without the shedding of blood, where would we be? Without Jesus, the song says, where would we be? In the fifth verse, and I want to pick up, it says, in the 24th verse, therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Somebody might say, oh, he's preaching. He's preaching to the wives. He's preaching to the sisters. You could not be more wrong and so far from the truth. That's not what I'm emphasizing. No, sir. Let me tell you what it is. Husbands, love your wives. Here's what I want to emphasize. Even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Brother, sister, a great price was paid for you and I, for our salvation that brought us together. Tonight we are assembled together in one common faith, one common belief, restored up on one foundational truth of the Word of God. We don't come together with different ideas. We don't come together, maybe, and some bring in this ideology, and it could be this way, it could be that way. There is only one way. Hallelujah. And we are in that way tonight. Some people may say, you brag a little bit. I've got something to brag about. And that's Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. There's a lot of churches that can, they call themselves churches. They're really lodges. They're social organizations. Amen. Somebody might not like what I'm saying that could be a part of one of those. Not here. I know that. But that's all right. See, we don't always know who is tuned in. So I don't say these things to be offensive, but I say them because they're true. Amen. They call themselves churches, but they yet don't offer anything of the Word of God to be of a help to grow anything. It's all watered down. Amen. You know, if you put a plant in soil, you can go to the store and you can buy what's called potting soil. And I'm sure many of you have purchased it. Especially this time of year, you're getting your plants going and your flowers and such. And in that soil, there are minerals and nutrients that those plants are going to need to be able to thrive and to grow and to produce maybe the flower and the color that's in that flower, or maybe that nice big juicy red tomato that you like so well. Amen. But they draw the nutrients from the soil combined with the light. There's a process of the light going through the leaves and all of this, and it feeds that plant. Amen. To produce the fruit. And we are the same. Hallelujah. We must be rooted in the richness of the Word of God. Hallelujah. We can't be planted in some watered down, nutrient-less condition. But we are growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Ephesians. Back there, let me finish reading that. Husbands, love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Can you say praise the Lord? Amen. How many sees a picture here of a work that is in progress? But let me tell you something else. It is for sure a work that is in progress, but it is nearing the end of its completion. Hallelujah. I've spoken to you many times and I've said, we are assembled together. This is the greatest gathering that there has been known in our day. Oh, somebody may disagree with me there. But as Brother Allen, he was speaking this morning. And Brother Sister, Brother Branham, he fulfilled that scripture there in Matthew, the 37th verse of that net going and being thrown out, and it gathered fishes of every kind. Hallelujah. It reached out into the far reaches of your denominational systems. Hallelujah. And let me tell you, the work that Brother Branham was sent to do, he fulfilled it to the T. Nothing was left undone. Amen. That's why that ideology and that, maybe you'll call it a revelation. I don't know what they call it. But it was incorrect. They said he was going to rise again. And he was going to come back and fulfill something. Let me tell you, he fulfilled everything God sent him to do. Amen. And when he met with Brother Jackson, and he said, Brother Jackson, something, Brother Junie, they'd get me if I quoted him wrong, right? Brother Junie, he said, something's getting ready to happen. He said, and when it does, he said, what? Say it, church. You stick with the word. Amen. And you know what? He never veered off of it. Look at the ridicule. Look at the ridicule he took and was called a blackbird. The congregation were blackbirds and you name it. What was it? You know, when you stand for something. Brother Allen said something yesterday. It stuck with me. There was a songwriter that wrote a song. He said, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for everything. Hallelujah. Did I quote that right, Brother Allen? Close enough. But you know what? We got something we're standing for. I realize that as we have come down through time, we've seen many that have come and gone. And some even have testified. I know that this is where the truth is at. Amen. I know this is where they're at. This is where the truth is. And I'm so glad God led me to the lighthouse. But unfortunately, give things a little time. And I will tell you that everything will manifest what it is on the inside. Everything. But brother, sister, tonight, it says in the 27th verse that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Hallelujah. I believe the church of the living God, when she is raptured out of here, she will be completed in her perfected state. Amen. And she will be rid completely of all unbelief. I read that out of 2 Corinthians. To separate yourself. Don't be yoked up with unbelievers. What fellowship hath light with darkness? Or maybe it says, what communion hath light with darkness? That's what it says. There is none. There comes a time, brother, sister. And I believe we're walking in that time. Hallelujah. God ridding us of all unbelief. Hallelujah. As I've said it to you many times, just as they gathered, they're in the upper room. They really did not know just what to expect. But they were following the words that they were given. Why is that? Because they believed it. There was no doubt. They had witnessed something in their hour through the life and the ministry of Jesus. They had faith and they had a knowledge of what they seen was of God. How much more us today? Hallelujah. The same. I was thinking about that, and Brother Allen, he was speaking on it this morning. You know, about those, the different things and the supernatural working there in the ministry of Brother Branham. How it reached out. And it was that drawing that got the attention. That net capturing those fish. Then he talked about they drew it to shore and they began to separate out. And brother, sister, I have to say tonight there's been a great, great amount of separation. Hallelujah. I know that down through the days, some of it was hard. Some of it struck close to the home. Right into the family. But let me remind you of what Jesus said. He said, "Who is my family?" Amen. "Those that do the will of my Father, which is in heaven." How many is wanting to do the will of God? Amen. That means more to us than anything. Is that right? There's been refining, sifting, sorting, filtering. In my words, I'm putting it down. As I've said to you, God is reducing. Amen. He's bringing a richness. Let me assure you of something. There is a great move of God that is right on the doorstep for the church. Amen. I mean, he's ready for that. We're getting ready together, brother, sister. That scripture I quoted there a while ago, it says, "For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness?" We're not fanatics. I would never want to ever plant that thought. We're in this world, but, brother, sister, we're not of this world. But God is working in and through us as individuals. There I've preached many times. I felt led to preach 1 Corinthians chapter 12 on the body. Because I believe, brother, sister, we must function as a body that is unified. Amen. I believe that God is working on us as individuals. When I spoke to you about all unbelief being removed, I said, I don't know if that represents individuals or just things in our life, but I have a good unction that there's a great amount of things in our life, maybe, that we are all looking at and saying, God, help me. Amen. But I believe that He is. Because the desire in our heart is to give way to God, that He would have preeminence in everything in our lives. You watch the things begin to fade. The things of the world, they begin to fade. And those desires, they begin to fade away. And your desire is more focused upon God and serving Him. Right. Hallelujah. Is that right? It is right. There's a cost. You said, Brother Kevin, I thought you said the price, it was already paid. It was for our salvation. But when you choose to walk this way and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, there is a battle that begins. Hallelujah. And let me tell you right now, even though He has no chance of winning this one, that don't mean He's not going to try to make your way rough. Turn with me to the book of Matthew in the 16th chapter. I want to read 3 verses of scripture there, I believe. Yes, Matthew chapter 16, the 24th verse. Then said Jesus unto His disciples, if any man will come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow Me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for My sake shall find it. Hallelujah. Brother, sister, I'm standing before you tonight, and I believe that I'm standing before many, hallelujah, that has give up their life for gain. Amen. We have given up any ties to our own aggressions or our own ambitions. Some may have aggressions, I don't know. But He'll take that away too. But we have given up maybe our own desires and said, Lord, I want You to have Your way in my life. We've seen many how the hand of God has moved them. And I'm physically meaning move them. When they come to the knowledge of the truth, they could have stayed living maybe where they did, and please don't take me as I'm saying someone needs to move in the geographical way. But do let me clarify something. As when God gets ready, you got to move. That's in a different way. But we have seen the Word of God and how it has had an effect, and the desire for the truth was so strong that as they analyzed the situation, and it was, there is no choice, but we've got to pick up our tent stakes and we've got to move. Because it's our desire to be there. Hallelujah. I'm thankful for the internet today. For these services are broadcast. And it has made much difference in those that are able now to be able to get it live. I remember back in the day, Brother Sister Berta has probably mailed out, I'm not even going to guess how many copies of cassette tapes. Many, weekly, that were sent out. Because there was a hunger for the Word of God, because it was doing something in the lives of individuals. It's still working. And it's working in our lives today. Working toward that perfected state that the church will be, in which we just read, without spot or blemish or any such thing. It says in the 26th verse, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What a thought. Then he comes right around and says, or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? We're moving right along, brother, sister. We've seen many, as I've already said, many that have come and they've gone and they've professed. We've seen see them walk for a while and seemingly do so good. But brother, sister, I've seen them fall, and when they fall very hard. But there has been that element all along that has been stable. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me say that again. There's been that element all along that has been steady and stable. No matter what come and what go. Amen. Not that it has any significance in comparison to the words of Jesus when he told them to go to Jerusalem and tarry until they were endued with power from on high. I'm not trying to compare that to the same words. But I'm standing before you because we know and we believe that God sent a man, which was spoken of this morning, in our day and in our hour, that turned us back to the Word. Hallelujah. And as I've already said, just before God takes his servant, amen, he already had a man schooled and lined up, I'll say. What is it for? God is going to start with something, but he's going to end up with what he said in his word he would have. A glorious church. Brother Jackson would say, he would preach on messages as God gave him the revelation. And he would preach on those things, and he had critics. He had scoffers. And he would say, just stick around. We'll see who's right. Amen. And you know what? There's been many that were here and they're no longer here. Amen. What is that? That's that unbelief departing. Amen. Let me tell you, Brother Branham was a man that was sent of God. Brother Jackson was a man sent of God. We have men today that are ordained of God. What is that? The church is moving ever closer to that perfected state. What did he say in Ephesians 4 about the ministry? It is for the perfecting of the saints, for the church, the edifying of itself in love. Amen. And as each minister from time to time steps into this pulpit, or maybe some pulpit around this world, this is a universal thing. Amen. Anointed of God with a message. There is something in that for the church. There is something in it for her growth, for her betterment, for her understanding. Brother, sister, I wrote down in my notes, again, this too was mentioned this morning. About the church of Laodicea, which really typed our day. As Brother Allen said, Laodicea is over. It is dead. But I went back and I reread that. You might want to turn there in the Revelation 3, the third chapter. I just want to read that 17th verse, where he says, because thou sayest. He's looking at an attitude. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods. Looking at it from a natural standpoint. Hallelujah. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, not even God they don't need. Because you find there when you get to the end, Jesus is on the outside knocking. Hallelujah. But I'm thankful tonight there's a group of people that are getting ready to leave. Jesus Christ is abiding on the inside. Every time we come together and assemble ourselves, he's in our presence. He's in our midst. Some may have looked at me a little strange the other day when I said that Jesus Christ that walked the shores of Galilee, he's not in his literal form tonight, but he's right here in spirit. Oh, church, you watch. You say, Brother Kevin, you keep saying all this unbelief. Where could it be? I don't know. Examine yourselves. I'm not saying you're harboring it. I'm not pointing out what it could be or who it might be. That's not important. What is important is that we seek the Lord. That we find ourselves in tune with God. Ridding ourselves of the cares of this life. You know, You cannot mix serving God and trying to live in the world. It won't mix. No, sir. That's why many times I've expressed to you, and I respectfully and lightly do I say it, you know, again, I say it. When the angel of the Lord, he spoke to Brother Branham, he said, now, if you can just get the people to believe, think about that. Some may say, well, that was just for his ministry, and it may well have just been. But there's a significance to what he was really saying about that. Because you have got to believe with all of your heart. There cannot be unbelief. And as I look and I know that there is a great move of God on the doorstep of the church, that tells me there's got to be no unbelief, because it's going to be a move like you have never seen before. Oh my. When we see God bear his holy arm in Israel, I believe it's already, things are getting lined up. Let me say it that way. And as you see, as it's written there in Micah, the 7th chapter, let's just read that. Sure, everybody got there before I did. I'm sorry. Well, Micah chapter 7. In the 16th verse, it says, the nations shall see and be confounded at all their might. They shall lay their hand upon their mouth. Their ears shall be deaf. They shall lick the dust like a serpent. They shall move out of their holes like worms of the earth. When Israel begins to make a move, and I believe she's being pressed right now. As Brother Allen said this morning, Schumer opened his mouth and he said, Netanyahu, you are an obstacle to peace. I say, praise the Lord. He said Israel needs to put him out and have new elections. And Israel put him in his place. It's none of your business, Schumer. Why don't you take care of business in your own house? Amen. How can you run Israel when you can't run your own country? Amen. When we begin to see that move, brother, sister, and when that 7th seal is opened and those 7 thunders begin to sound, do you think there's going to be a stirring in the church? when we see and witness what God is doing in Israel, and we see fulfilled what we have been taught and told, that they will get their land back all the way to the Euphrates River. And they're saying from the river to the sea that they're going to liberate Palestine. I think I done told you I read what one of the Jews wrote. He said, from the desert to the coast, Gaza will make it toast. And I said, praise the Lord. Is it because I'm against those people? No, sir. But I'm for the word of God's being fulfilled. Amen. Hallelujah. See Israel back in her homeland like she is. Then when we see that temple begin to be built. Brother, sister, I believe there's going to be some shouting. We'll know that our days upon this earth are numbered. Right. Hallelujah. We'll be thankful for what we have stood for. We've known to be right and true. Amen. Because as I said earlier, the word of God is yea, and it is amen. It is sure. In the book of Isaiah, brother, sister, in the 54th chapter, in the 17th verse, I'm just quoting you one there. It says, no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment, that shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. And their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. This battle's not ours, but it's his. We're on the winning side tonight. I feel good in my soul. Hallelujah. You know, there's been times when you see the waters are troubled and you see that people are making decisions and you're thinking, God, you're praying for them. God, help them that they make the right choice. I don't want to see any soul lost or reject any kind of truth ever, but I can't give it to them. That's the decision I'm speaking of. I can't make that decision for them. That's why, brother, sister, how many times did I preach and I would say, there are conscious decisions. The watchmen are responsible to speak what God puts on their heart. Go back if you want to in the archives and begin to watch. But it was a warning. Conscious decisions are being made, and yet it was all out rejected. That's right. Some may say, well, it was the way you said it. I said it with a sense of urgency because lives are at stake. Souls, I should say, are at stake. But as I said the other day, you know you... No, I'm not saying that. Verse 18 there in Micah 7, it says, who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger forever because he delighteth in mercy. He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities. Thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. God's gonna forgive Israel for her transgressions. He's already led her back to her homeland. He's already putting everything in place. How about the church? Are we there? Not quite, but we're getting close. When all God's children get there, we're going to have a good time. I can't help but think tonight, Brother Jackson was sitting on this platform, he'd be a happy man. He would be proud. But saying that, we're not here to please man. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. Tonight, we lift up the name of Jesus Christ that has made all this possible. I do want to go into the book of Colossians for just a moment. I may close right here. I want to thank Brother Mike Hamby for getting me a new Bible. I'll be using that starting next week, Brother Mike. Until then, I have a portable copy of the Bible right here. But it's just a portion of Philippians. But I keep it handy. Colossians chapter 3. Brother, sister, I believe that the devil, he's working overtime. He's trying to do all that he can. There's an old saying, I got accused of it when I was a child. And we were out in the neighborhood playing. But I had went home. I think I was called home for supper. And we were eating at the supper table and there would come a knock on the door. And it was the neighbors came. And they said, Kevin stuck a stick in our son's bicycle wheel as he was riding it. And I did not, but I got blamed for it. And that's not good if you've never had that happen. If you're riding down the road and you stick something in those spokes, something bad's going to happen. But the devil is trying all he can do. I'll finish that story for those that like endings. I was proven innocent. They had a meeting on the back porch of the neighbor's property, and the guy that did it ended up admitting he did it. Because I was sitting there bawling my eyes out. I said, I did not do this. I don't know how my name got brought into this, but I wasn't even there when it happened. But somebody put me at the crime scene. You got to watch that artificial intelligence. You know they can do that. They can impose your image. Scary stuff. They can put you at a crime scene. And you weren't even there. If they can just get a little bit of a recording of your voice. I know I switch gears. I'm on AI. Artificial intelligence. If they can get just a little snippet of your voice, they can make you say anything. Do you know that? Don't you ever answer the phone and when you get that recording it says, is this Mr. So-and-so? Don't say yes. Hang up the phone. Those recordings are trying to get something. Not all of them, maybe. I shouldn't say that. But that's one way they try to get it. But the devil's doing all that he can today to put a spoke in the wheel, or a stick in the spokes of the wheel. He wants to see someone crash. He wants to see someone troubled. He wants to mix misery. He wants to break up happiness and joy and contentment. He's doing all that he can. So, brother, sister, my advice to us tonight, as the church of the living God, let us be careful what we entertain. Because I'll tell you that the devil, he's wise in his tactics. Let us read here in Colossians chapter 3. He said, if you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Then he says, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. I want to drop on down to the 12th verse. It says, put on therefore as the elect of God. And I believe, brother, sister, we are the elect of God. Amen. Holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, and long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. The devil, he would like us to harbor hard feelings. He'd like us to harbor things against someone. And many times they don't even know that they exist. So you know who it hurts? The one that harbors that. Amen. I believe that the love of God is in our hearts. And it abounds in and through the church. I believe that we're mature Christians. As I said earlier, we're all desiring and seeking after the same thing. We're adult enough in the scriptures, I'll say it that way, that we ought to be able to go to one another and say, brother, sister, and deal with things in a way that would bring about a resolution that God would be pleased in. Amen. Amen. And also, that would not, what does it say there? You don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit of God. That's what I'm trying to help with. We don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Put on therefore as the elect of God, holy and beloved, and bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you. When I said, I read there about Laodicea, and I said he's dealing there with the attitude, and I didn't finish that either. We are beyond Laodicea. If the attitude was that way and he wrote about it when it was going on, How bad is it today that they have not repented and they have continued in their ways? If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, we have a responsibility tonight. Amen. Even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. Hallelujah. Sometimes we can carry burdens that are so heavy. Amen. Sometimes we can carry things around with us that just weights us down. Amen. But I say expose the devil. I say just let him know he's not in charge. I believe we're in a church. I believe we're in the church of the living God. And I believe that the scripture is pointing us and it is directing us. As I said, we are on our way and we are very close to that state in which is described in the book of Ephesians, the 4th chapter. Let me say, as I've mentioned many times, brother, sister, that song that Sister Mayfield would sing, I don't want nothing here to hinder me. And you know what? I don't want anything in my life to hinder the church. It's another way to look at it. Amen. We are a body. And we have an effect upon every member. He says, above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. I think I said I was going to close there, maybe. Well, I would like to beg. No, I don't beg. I was going to forgiveness, maybe. There, I'm teaching on forgiveness. Now I'm asking for some. I do want to read in one more place. And that is in the book of Jude. The 20th verse. I cannot tell you that there are any that will identify the error of their way. But I pray there are. Brother, sister, I believe if we're going to be Christ-like, that's a Christian. I believe Jesus, He showed the greatest amount of compassion. You believe that? I don't compromise with error, but I'm looking up on the soul. That's what I'm looking at. I would pray that those that have made an error in their judgment would identify the error of their way and make that right. That is what I would pray. Yeah. Jesus gave that opportunity many times. It was not always accepted, but the offer always stood. And I believe, as the song says, the offer still stands tonight. How much longer? I don't know. He says in the 20th verse, "But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God." That's my title, by the way. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life, and of some having compassion, making a difference. Amen. Hallelujah. If I can show compassion, please understand me, not compromise. No, sir. I will not compromise on the word of God. No, sir. But I will show compassion to those that will recognize the error of their way and desire to make it right. I don't know how much more I could extend an olive branch. Amen. This thing is almost over. As far as an opportunity to make things right. When that seventh seal is broken, those thunders begin to sound. Brother, sister, that door of grace is closed. And of some having compassion, making a difference. And others saved with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Not too many services ago, I had made mention, and I'd said, I don't know why that it's on my heart, but I'd said, if there were a soul that came in through that back door and said, "Brother Kevin, you know, I was led astray," and I believe many were. I believe that it was, in fact, Jude. That's what he was speaking of when he was writing that book. Those that would come to deceive. He saw the apostasy that set in the church and how it led to sinful and ungodly living. And you know what? Brother, sister, I want to tell you something. I said earlier, when some fall, they fall hard. There's some that have declared this to be the lighthouse, and they have walked away, and today you would not recognize them. Just look upon them. Am I preaching too hard? I said, if someone come through that back door and they said, "Brother Kevin, would it be possible? I have made a grave error because I had so much confidence in a man, in an individual." Let me say it that way. But it was a man. We don't believe in women preachers. I had so much confidence in that man, I just knew he had to be right. So I followed him. But now that I look in the scripture and I see what is being fulfilled, I know we're living in the third day. It's been revealed to me. It has to be. Amen. Why did some grab it and some didn't? It has to be revealed. That too, I'll say in itself, There is Brother Jackson. He preached on that countdown. God let him see up to a certain point in time. And he preached every bit that he saw. But there, he died in December 2004. Is that right? And he said, I believe it was 2004 and a half, five and a half. I don't remember. I'm getting my dates mixed up now. But he had put on that chart. God give him every one of those scriptures and showed him that timeline. I believe we're a wise people. No, we're not saying we know the day and the hour. But God has given us the understanding of the day we're living in and just how close we are. When we crossed over that, as Brother Allen demonstrated to us, and he crossed that threshold, when you leave the second day, you step into the third day. I believe I could teach my grandchildren that. Oh, but the third day is the millennium. Let me correct you on that. The millennium is in the third day. Get it right. If you're going to quote scripture, get it right. Plus, that is a prophecy to the Jew. I'm happy. I'd love to see the church packed out with believers. And tonight, I believe it is. You say, well, Brother Kevin, there's a seat beside me. It's full. If there's one believer in that seat, the whole seat's full. Brother Branham said one time when that preacher tried to talk to him, Pentecostal preacher, I believe he said, Brother Branham, he said, you're just too hard on the women. Just too hard on them. He said, you preach and you tell them they can't cut their hair and they can't wear the makeup and this and that. And he said, you're just too hard on the women. He said, you're going to run them all off. He said, I'd rather preach to that pole right there than a church full of unbelievers. I have to say amen. You love the Lord. I'm ready to stop. I feel I should. I love the Lord and I'll stand for his word. I'll preach it just as he gives it to me. And brother, sister, this thing is wrapping up. We're nearing the end. It would behoove us all to just do all that we can. Amen. And it's not about works. That's not what I'm saying. But draw closer to the Lord. Submit ourselves unto him. Amen. I believe when we do that, the devil has to flee. You love him? Let us pray. Heavenly Father and Almighty God, as we look to you again, we thank you, Lord, and we praise you for your goodness, your grace and mercy that you have bestowed upon us. Lord, that you have led us to this marvelous light, this truth, Lord, that we have. And I ask, Father, that you would bless every heart and soul that is here. Those that have been tuned in, Lord, by way of the internet. All the way from the coast of California, over to England, Lord. South Africa, Canada, all around this world. You know where every believer is, Lord. And you know how to speak into their heart and soul. May, Father, your presence be in their midst. Lord, I pray for each and every need. I pray for Sister Carla. The family, Lord, as Brother Allen has departed this life. I pray that you would comfort them and give them peace in their heart and in their mind. And be with them, Lord, in the days ahead. May you strengthen them, Lord. I pray, Lord, for Sister Carmen again and her family. I thank you, Lord, for that opportunity to make that journey. To be able to speak maybe a few words that would be of a help to someone. All of this, Lord, is for your honor and your glory, for your will and purpose to be fulfilled. I commit this that's been said tonight into your hands. And I ask it in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Right. Praise the Lord. May the Lord bless you tonight. Go with you. I'll turn the service back over to Brother Allen.
Thank you, Brother Kevin, tonight. Appreciate the message that we've heard. Sometimes words are needed to be said that would kind of shake us, get us awake, rise and wake, for the light has come.
Praise the Lord.
We thank God for the light that He has brought into us. Let's stand, please. Come on, Brother David. Thanks again, Brother Kevin.
Lord, you
the battle. And when my trials have got the best of me, and when my faith is fleeting and vanished, oh Lord, in my mind I just go back to Mount Calvary. Oh, 'cause Lord, for he knew the chance he was taking. Will the crowd say, "Be quiet, don't bother him now"? But the more they pressed him, the louder he'd shout, "Thou Son of David, have mercy on me." And today I believe he can see. He is more than enough to make the blind man to see. He's more than enough to guide you and me. He's more than enough to turn the water into wine. He's more than enough to feed a family like mine. He's more than enough to heal all disease. He's more than enough to wash the sin out of me. If he can raise up the dead and give him new life, then Jesus is more than enough. He said to the Lord, "My daughter is dying at home." Then another man said, "She's dead, leave the master alone." What was said, his heart was grieved. He said, "Be not afraid, but only believe." And then he spoke to that child, "I say unto thee, arise." And she came alive. And he is more than enough to make the blind man to see. He's more than enough to guide you and me. He's more than enough to turn the water into wine, and he's more than enough to feed a family like mine. He's more than enough to heal all diseases. He's more than enough to wash the sin out of me. If he can raise up the dead and give him new life, then Jesus is more than enough. He is more than enough to make the blind man to see. He's more than enough to guide you and me. And he's more than enough to turn the water into wine. He's more than enough to feed a family like mine. He's more than enough to heal all disease. He's more than enough to wash the sin out of me. If he can raise up the dead and give him new life, then Jesus is more than enough.
Amen. Just remember the funeral Tuesday for the family up there. And Brother Rick, I'll have you praise. We're dismissed tonight if you would.
Father, your son is more than enough. Lord, we just thank you for the many blessings of life that you've given this world for us. What we have, Father, is so precious and valuable. Lord, men of the world, they'll do anything they can to get wealth. They'll lie, cheat, steal, and kill. But Father, what we have is worth more than any wealth and money on the face of this earth.
Amen.
Father, all the wealth in the world cannot buy. But there's a small group of people, Father, that believe it. And Father, we just thank you for that.
Yes.
The men of the world don't even want it. But we thank you that you're both people that does want it, Father. And I thank you for your love and mercy. And I pray that your will would be done in everything that we say and do.
Yes.
And I thank you for it in Jesus Christ's name. I pray.